Greetings and welcome to Farhang Foundation's latest virtual talk in collaboration with the Iranian Studies Initiative at the University of California, Santa Barbara. I am Ali Reza Ardakani, Executive Director of Farhang Foundation here in Los Angeles. We are a member-supported, non-political, non-religious, not-for-profit organization with the sole mission to celebrate and promote Iranian art and culture for the benefit of the community at large. Today, we are delighted to welcome our guest speaker, Dr. Sam Hodgkin of Yale University for Newspaper Poetry and Representative Politics in the Revolutions of 1905 through 1911. Now it is my pleasure to welcome Dr. Janet Afari, the director of the Iranian Studies Initiative at the University of California, Santa Barbara.
Thank you, Mr. Ardakani.
Good morning.
Good morning. Hello, I'm Janet Afari, director of the Iranian Studies Initiative at the University of California, Santa Barbara. And I'd like to welcome you all to the second talk this year in our lecture series in collaboration with Farhang Foundation. Our focus this year is on the artistic and literary exchanges between Iran, South Caucasus, where it's today Azerbaijan, Armenia, Georgia, Central Asia, and Russia in the 20th century, especially the contribution of Iranian diasporic communities. Our speaker today is Dr. Sam Hodgkin. He's an assistant professor of comparative literature at Yale University and has published extensively on the modern verse, theater, and criticism of Iran, Turkey, the Caucasus, and Central Asia. His current book project entitled The Nightingale's Congress, Poetics of the Persianate International, shows how the Soviet internationalist project of world literature emerged from sustained engagement between leftist writers of West Asia and South Asia and state-sponsored writers of the multinational Soviet East. The Q&A will be conducted by Dr. Farshad Sumbuldel, who is the Middle East librarian and area studies collection strategist at UC Santa Barbara. Dr. Sumbuldel is a poet, literary critic, and researcher in modern Persian literature. His forthcoming monograph is titled The Rebellion of Poetic Forms, Politics of Poetic Experimentation in Modern Persian Poetry. I hope you join us for the remainder of the lecture series, which will continue through May of 2022. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. And good morning or afternoon, everyone. And I would like to thank my hosts at UC Santa Barbara's Iranian Studies Initiative and at the Farhang Foundation, including Ali Reza Ardakani at Farhang, Kristen Donka at UCSB, and most of all, the Ustad whose whole career of brilliant work on the international dimensions of Iranian revolutionary movements really set the agenda for the work I'm presenting today, Professor Janet Afari. The cartoon you can see here from an Azeri language satirical journal that was published in Tiflis and read from Istanbul to Tehran to Bukhara celebrates the bumper crop of new periodicals, mostly short-lived, that sprung up after the Russian Revolution of 1905 and that would soon have counterparts in Iran and the Ottoman lands, similarly influential and short-lived after their own constitutional revolutions. Today, I'm going to talk about the effect that these periodicals had on Persian poetry. And I'll just say, I know this talk was advertised for a general audience, and there are also many colleagues here who know this period and this poetry very well. So I'll try to provide enough background while also giving specialists some sense of how I hope to move the conversation forward. The significance of occasional newspaper verse for Persian literary modernity might be hard for readers today to conceive. The contemporary American critic Jahan Ramazani's conception of poetry that I quote here as intractably hostile to the logic of the news media as its anti-genre sums up a grand tradition of English language post-romantic poetics and criticism. Literature, as Ezra Pound says, is news that stays news, at arm's length from the immediate demands of the contemporary and the political, it produces more durable truths. And closer to the case at hand, but according to the same logic, we have Mohammad Taqi Bahar, one of the most influential poets and critics of the golden age of Iranian newspaper poetry, starting off the first issue of his literary journal with a dig at newspaper poets as, quote, literary and political brokers and carpenters, tradesmen, not real artists. For the moderate poetic reformer Bahar, as for the avant-gardists in contemporaneous European poetry, the little magazine, not the newspaper, is where real poetry happens. And yet, by general agreement of critics, including Bahar, the verse satires and screeds published in the Iranian press, however ephemeral and workmanlike, mark the transition between the classical tradition and Persian poetic modernity. As Ahmad Karimi Hakok describes the critical consensus, quote, Constitution era poetry is more political and encodes the attitude of the poet toward the socio-political events of the time in a way different from what a classical ghazal or qasida would. Karimi Hakok and other scholars of Persian literary modernity have done a lot to elucidate the nature of that difference. As he puts it, this corresponds in some respects to the modern transformation of other Persian poetic traditions. There's an incisive recent article by Fatima Birni on the aspiration to worldliness in the verse of late 19th century Urdu reformers who objected to the hostility to the ephemeral world in classical verse. So this talk contributes to that conversation on the new worldliness of Persian verse in the age of the newspaper, its role in speaking into existence, not just a new Iran, but also a wider revolutionary world. My main contribution here is to show that the worldliness of constitutionalist poetry has everything to do with the most urgent question of the revolutionary years, the question of political representation. As political parties, secret societies, and periodicals struggle to determine who can legitimately speak on behalf of the people, occasional verse is, without hyperbole, one of the most important sites for the emergence of a new poetics of political representation across imperial and linguistic boundaries. Before going any further, I'll just provide some basic points of orientation for non-scholars. And the chronology shown here covering early 20th century revolutions in the Ottoman Empire, Russia, and Iran is, I know, kind of sprawling and intimidating, but it's still extremely reductive, leaving out lots of crucial events. I mean, it's much more than can be discussed in a brief introduction to a lecture on poetry. But what I want non-expert listeners to be able to visualize is that the period from 1905 to 1926 is a period of entangled and frequently synchronized transformations, beginning with the revolutions from 1905 to 1908, that established short-lived parliamentary systems of government in all three empires. You can see them lined up in red there. And ending with the revolutions from 1917 to 1926, which replaced all three dynastic empires with fundamentally new political entities. Most of the territory of the Russian Empire becomes the Soviet Union, the Anatolian heartland of the Ottoman Empire becomes the Turkish Republic, and the Qajar dynasty in Iran is replaced by a constitutional monarchy, making Iran a nation state like Turkey. If we group Anatolia and Iran with the Turco-Persian regions of the Russian Empire and the Soviet Union in the Caucasus and Central Asia, it becomes clear that these are not three parallel transitions. They comprise a single chain of cause and effect, in which all the major parties and revolutionary organizations have branches or affiliates in multiple states. Fighters, money, weapons, and periodicals flow back and forth across borders as different zones become more or less hospitable for revolution, and revolutionaries in each state are constantly modeling their manifestos, constitutions, and tactics on their peers in the other states. All of this has been well established for decades now for political and social historians. As I say, Professor Afari played a big role in establishing this picture. But it still isn't how most literary scholars think about this period. Laudable exceptions include Hassan Javadi, Ali Qaisari, Kelsey Rice, and Nargis Ertürk. particular empires or nations still function as the unit of analysis, with emigre writers and periodicals treated as part of their respective national literatures. Across borders, critics acknowledge particular traveling writers and texts as nodes of influence or reception and compare parallel developments, but rarely is this zone conceived of as a single literary sphere. In fact, communities of readers and writers and illiterate sloganeers grouped around particular locales or periodicals were actually linked across borders, not by a few nodes of contact, but by long-term broad-based entanglement across political and linguistic divides. There were plenty of barriers and asymmetries, of course. A large proportion of early 20th century Iranian literatures were Turkish bilingual and read contemporary Azeri and Ottoman works at least as readily as Persian ones. Whereas not as many Ottoman Turkish readers kept up with Iranian Persian works, although Turks in Transcaucasia did. Central Asians read Iranian and Ottoman and Azeri Turkish publications avidly, but their own contributions rarely circulated so widely. Still, even in the directions that I've identified as less permeable, literary reception was quite extensive, and crucially, much more extensive than the direct reception of French, German, and English literature. Even so, the story of Turkic and Persian literary modernity has often been told as if it were primarily a matter of writers' encounter with European literature. This is mostly a matter of the sociology of literary criticism. Over the past century, both Iranian and Western scholars of Persian literature have operated in milieus where they're better rewarded for familiarity with Western classics of the long 19th century than late Ottoman literature. And I should say that older generations of Iranian literary scholars were well aware of the entanglement of Turkic and Persian literary modernities and referred frequently to Iranian translations or adaptations of Ottoman and Azeri models. But this usually functions as background knowledge for narratives of Iranian national literary modernization through the reception, direct or indirect, of Western models. My talk today is mostly concerned with poetry from the first round of constitutional revolutions from 1905 to 1912. But the question of the role of Turkic models, especially Ottoman Turkish models, in the transformation of Persian poetry really comes to a head between 1918 and 1920 in Tabriz, beyond the frame of today's talk, where the anti-Soviet but leftist revolutionary movement of Mohammad Khiabani is accompanied by two periodicals, the newspaper Tajaddud and the pedagogical journal Azadistan, that together publish the most radical formal experiments thus far in Persian verse, especially by Mohammad Taqi Rafat and the woman poet Shamsi Kasmai, who wrote Iran's first Persian language free verse. They were widely accused of mechanically importing from Ottoman Turkish verse forms that wouldn't work in Persian. But the roots of this polemic are in the newspaper verse of 1905. This survey would be incomplete without noting that there are other overlays of non-Turco-Persian revolutionary movements and literary communities that extend across imperial boundaries and are variously entangled with Turco-Persian literature. The most important of these is the Armenian case. As Huri Barbarian shows so well in her work, Armenians held the three revolutions together. And I've been slowly, inexpertly trying to get a sense of Armenian revolutionary poetry's entanglements, limited but still important, with Turkic and Persian constitutionalist poetry. Recently, I've been starting to read Armenian poetry as a point of comparison, whose parallels and divergences reveal the options available to Turco-Persian constitutionalist poets, and the narrower set of options among which they chose in practice. But I won't get so much chance to talk about that aspect today. So let's begin with a quick tour of the kinds of periodicals in which you might find the poetry I'll discuss today. So newspapers are a heterogeneous category, but we'll distinguish them not so much by their frequency of publication. The Persian term ruznome for newspaper specifies that it should be daily, but this is not always the case, especially for banned emigre papers that were smuggled in from abroad. Rather, they're defined by their miscellany, which jams poems alongside straight news articles, ads, and so on. Many papers had a daily or occasional column or two devoted to occasional verse or literary criticism, which were by the late 1910s often labeled as adabiyat, a word that was coming to function as a calque for the Western term literature. Some papers specialized in literature, which could comprise half or more of the contents, and had a resident writer who produced most or all of the literary contents. This was true, for example, of Sura Esrafil, which is on your left, whose famous satirical column by Ali Akbar Dehoda, Charando Parand, was really the highlight of each issue. And as many of you know, Professor Afari recently co-authored a brilliant annotated translation of this column. Or of Nassim Shamal, whose poet editor Ashraf you'll hear more about later on. But note that the political function of newspaper poetry in Iran precedes the constitutional revolution and develops by stages from a form of public occasional poetry that is more like the poetry recited in a traditional court setting. So on the right here is a panegyric to the Qajar Shah that the reformist minister Zakha Mulk Furughi commissioned a very young poet named Lahuti, a member of the same Masonic secret society as Furughi, to compose for the Persian New Year. And regular attendees of this series will have heard about Lahuti's later Soviet career in Professor Clark's presentation last month. The poem performs the traditional seasonal function of the New Year's panegyric qasida, but it also uses puns to reflect on the new medium and new forms of intermediation that brought it before the Shah and into a different kind of public space, not the real immediate space of a recitation at court, but the virtual public sphere of the newspaper. Already here, on the eve of a new representative politics, we can see the reconfiguration of the conventional poetic forms that define the relationship between speaker, addressee, and witnesses. And I'd be happy to talk more about this poem at the end if people are interested. The satirical magazine is a sort of sibling form to the newspaper, its issues less frequent, its ambitions less wide-ranging, and its contents less heterogeneous, but resembling the newspaper in its immediacy, its deployment of poetry instrumentally as one more way of commenting on current events. Here, many of the poems are very short, and they often caption political cartoons, as on the cover of the Armenian magazine on the left. A conundrum here. In Azeri and Persian, the verse in Constitution-era satirical journals is the bleeding edge of formal experimentation, because it is especially likely to puncture classical formality with slang, vulgarity, and solecisms. See it write a poem by the major Azeri satirical poet Sabir, in which an ignorant old man mangles the words for socialism and democrat, socialism and demokrat, and they were also especially likely to break with classical prosody in search of the rhythms of everyday speech or the pacing of a good joke. Because Turkic language print poets have been using syllabic meters for decades by this point, both traditional oral Turkic meters and imported Western ones, and because Persian satirical poetry is particularly indebted to Turkic models, in these journals, all sorts of strange experiments take place that will only much later be undertaken by Persian poets who take themselves seriously. And yet, in Armenian poetry of the same period, nowhere are classical Persianate forms as much in evidence as in the satirical journals. See, for example, the Roba'i on the left. This is a form that's not so common in serious Armenian literature at this point. So here in Armenian, over the course of the 19th century, the consecration of an institution called literature on the post-Romantic European model has redefined Persianate verbal arts such as Ghazal, Roba'i, and Muhammas, which are still very much alive in Armenian, as popular song, and their composers as singers rather than poets. Satirical verse, being closer to the language and rhythm of the streets, is more classical. Whereas if a capital P poet uses a Persianate form, it is as self-orientalizing pastiche. In Ottoman Turkish poetry, in 1905, a similar reorganization of the literary field is just beginning to take place. I've distinguished satirical magazines as a really special medium from other types of topical periodicals, whether literary, political, or pedagogical. Because of these venues' delimited elite subscriber base, even politically radical poems go less far with the linguistic simplification or colloquialization that is the heart of Constitution-era formal play. Furthermore, in these settings, poetry is more often presented as literature in the newly institutionalized sense, which kind of constrains it in other ways. But in accordance with the later institutionalization of literature in Persian relative to, say, Turkish and Armenian, Iranian little magazines didn't proliferate until a few years after the Constitutional Revolution. So to conclude this tour, I want you to think of these types of venues as part of a media ecosystem that also includes not just the kinds of poetry collections that had been the long-term mainstays of Persianate poetic culture, one poet divans, multi-poet memorial collections called tazkirez, and the private commonplace books kept by readers, but also other new forms of circulation beyond the social spaces of poetic gatherings. We have less preserved evidence of the secret underground periodicals called shabnames that were distributed by night, or of the other sorts of pamphlets, but occasional verse played a role in these as well, that much we know. The art historian Mira Shverda has done fascinating research on the political use of photographic postcards, like the one that you see in this period. And here too, we see apposite quotations from verse circulating by mail. Most famously, the Iranian Constitutional Revolution was powered by protest songs, such as tasnifs, some of them written by specialist lyricists and some by the most famous poets of the time. Verse moved back and forth between written and sung form, and lines and couplets could also function as slogans during street protests. So here we're concerned with the different poems elicited by particular media, as well as with the different forms of the same poem as they change to suit the demands of particular media. The differences between venues structure the constitutionalist literary field. And part of why the question of medium is so high stakes is that after 1905, the object of political contestation is, where is the voice of the people to be heard? In the first instance, do the Shah, Sultan, and Tsar have sovereign authority to speak for their subjects? Or must spokespeople be elected by the people to speak on their behalf in a parliament? In all three empires, among the revolutionaries who forced autocrats to cede representational authority to parliaments, a loud subset questioned or rejected the legitimacy not just of autocrats, but also of parliaments as the voice of a people, given their usual elite makeup. Consequently, each party maintained both a parliamentary delegation and a network of associations, some of which were public and some armed underground cells that made decisions for the parliamentary party and engaged in a different kind of politics in the street. In Iran, these associations were called anjuman. In the Russian Empire, they're called sovets and would provide the sort of initial conceptual model for the Bolsheviks. So the two parties that ultimately achieved the greatest success with such a bifurcation between public government presence and non-transparent secret party apparatus were the Ottoman Committee for Union and Progress, or the Young Turks, and the Bolsheviks. But this arrangement structured politics everywhere in this period. In Iran, many of these were cross-border affiliates of parties headquartered elsewhere, such as the Iranian branches of the Armenian Dashnaks, or in the case of the Russian Social Democratic Labor Party, and especially their Baku-based Azeri counterpart, Hümet, an Iranian affiliate called the Social Democratic Party, and then in parentheses, militant. This is like the Social Democratic Labor Party, Bolshevik or Menshevik, and it's very much modeled on that. Even after the FIAM, as we're going to call it, had its place taken by a new Democrat party, Hezbollah Demokrat, that distanced itself from the now dominant Bolshevik faction of the RSDLP, the new party still had more militant anjuman counterparts in many cities. So the remainder of this presentation will deal primarily with poetry composed by poets and for periodicals associated with the SDLP and its affiliate parties and anjumans. So don't get too caught up again with this intricate diagram, but this is just to give you a sort of basic cognitive map here. And it may be fairly said that periodicals, especially newspapers, often provide the closest thing to a public voice of the underground parties. Lenin, who was an inveterate critic of the claims to represent the workers of parliamentary delegates and trade union spokesmen, and who was in general hostile to theorizations of legitimate political representation, suggested precisely this possibility in the course of the 1901 discussions that led to the SDLP's capture of the newspaper Pravda as the party organ. The proletariat, he writes in 1901, don't need a representative, but, quote, a tribune, a social democratic newspaper through which they can receive the summons to battle from the revolutionary vanguard and then engage in action themselves. The word tribune is a usefully ambiguous one. Is he talking about a voice, a person, or a medium, a newspaper? Remember that the Internationale, the anthem of socialists everywhere, insists that the people need neither God nor Caesar nor tribune. And Leninists have tended to insist that vanguard revolutionaries are not representatives. They're just catalysts to get the people to do the thing themselves. Either way, I want you to keep in mind the newspaper as a claimant to legitimate representation of the masses, whether as a representative voice or as a medium for the people's own voices. We can see this station underway in the FIAM, that is the Russian Communists Iranian Affiliate Party, after the reestablishment of the Iranian constitution in July 1909. The same poet whom we last encountered back in 1905 writing a panegyric to the Shah for a reformist newspaper, Lahuti, has now been fighting in the north in an FIAM militia, and he enters Tehran with the triumphant constitutionalist forces. And his next extant poem in a periodical after the panegyric to the Shah is not until around New Year 1910. It's published in the Tehran satirical journal Chanteye Pobrehne, so the barefoot's satchel, associated with the Democrat Party, no longer the FIAM, but its successor party in some ways. The poem asks the poor of Iran, how much longer will you suffer and toil while the notables' ease comes from your suffering? In keeping with the tone of such journals, it is delightedly vulgar, contrasting the workers' worries and cares with the pederastic delights of the wealthy, although the crucial word is starred in the newspaper. To dar ghami khod bichare sazi, ashraf be'esh o bachebazi. I mean, we can assume bachebazi. And I'll say from here on out, I'm going to read the quotes in Persian or Azeri, but on the slide is the English translation. So the poem concludes, Dani ke chera hamishe khari, zanru ke hami'i nadari, har kas ke mudafe'i nadarad, ke haqe khudesh bedast darad, asbab najat to vakil ast, garan ke vakil az shuma bud, dard to yaqin bedan dava shud. گران که وکیل شد از اعیان تو فاتح بحر خیش برخان. It should be emphasized that in spite of its advocacy of parliamentary elections as the means for the masses to get representation, and indeed its paternalistic suggestion that peasants are a flock in need of a shepherd, this poem reflects contemporaneous radical currents. The peasantry, systematically underrepresented by the parliamentary apportionment system, were, as Professor Alfari shows, then engaged in tax and rent strikes and land seizures in the Caspian regions where Lahouti had spent much of the previous year as a constitutionalist fighter. Against the actual composition of parliament, Lahouti insists that the only effectual representative of the peasants will be a peasant. Furthermore, he does so in a journal whose title declares it to be a bag full of sustenance or tools for the indigent masses to carry with them. In verse that follows, and he does it in verse that follows the classical rules of rhyme and meter only approximately. Even so, when the poem was reprinted in February 1911 in Iran-e-No, the newspaper of the Democrat Party, the final line, the newspaper as opposed to the satirical journal, the final lines that I just quoted had been excised. So the Democrat Party's parliamentary delegation may have been carefully distancing itself from the Bolsheviks, but their newspaper was not so committed to upholding the priority of the ballot box over the barricades. By the way, for a later Soviet anthology of his works, Lahouti completely rewrote the ending of the poem to advocate that the peasants form an anjuman through which they could get their rights by force. Between the two publications of that poem, Lahouti was briefly arrested by the constitutionalist police for another poem, published again first in Chante and then evidently in various Tehran newspapers, in which he mused, همه داد وطن خواهی زنند اما نمیدانم وطن خواهی به گفتار است یا کردار یا هر دو وطن را از خطر فکر وکیلان می کند امین و یا سرنیزه یک لشکر جرار یا هر دو وکیلان و وزیرانند خائن فاش می گویم اگر در زیر تیغم یا بروی دار یا هر دو. I'd like to suggest, based on my readings in the various types of periodical, that poetic gestures of anjuman-style militancy or vigilantism tended to move like this, first appearing in the satirical journals before being reprinted and disseminated to a wider readership by the newspapers. As the cases above suggest, the intimate link between revolutionary parties and newspapers and poetry, didn't just bring the political content of Ottoman or Azeri political verse into Persian poetry. It also carried ingredients for a new poetics, even when that didn't involve the transmission of syllabic meter or other obvious formal elements. One way to think about this shift is the Canadian new critic Northrop Frye's Radical of Presentation, a typology of genres based on their conventions of voice, address, and setting. Whose voice is assumed to be addressing whom, overheard by whom. So in the classical Persian panegyric Qasida, the poetic speaker is protean, shifting between several conventional personae, and likewise shifts abruptly between addressees, now speaking to the patron, now turning to the other attendees to describe the patron in third person. There is no convention, of course, for address to a wider public, at least until pre-constitution newspaper qasidas like the one you glimpsed earlier. In constitution era political verse, whether it's formally traditional or innovative, the lyric I is far more stable, and the conventions for apostrophizing the nation or the impoverished masses likewise stabilize remarkably quickly. This is a shift in the poetics of politics integrated with a shift in poetics as such. And we are dealing with both the poetics and politics of romantic nationalism, forged in Europe in the aftermath of the French Revolution. In fact, a full three decades before widespread experimentation with non-traditional verse forms in Persian, here already, we can see the aspect of Persianate poetic modernity that best fits with the diffusion model of modernization. Diffusion in the sense that most Iranian readers and writers re-encountered the romantic poetics of political representation through its appropriations and reinterpretations by Turcophone writers in the Ottoman and Romanov empires. You'd have to be very contrarian today to claim that the poets who wrote for the Russian SDLP newspapers represented the cutting edge of Russian verse from 1905 to 1917. And the same is true for the non-literatures of the Caucasus. For reasons of time, I've had to cut from this talk an Armenian case study dealing with a chain of poetic responses between the non-party leftist poet Avatik Isahakyan and the leading SDLP poet Hakopian, who shows the effect that party poetry has or had on the literary field as a whole. In Azeri and Persian, unlike in Russian and Armenian, leftist party politics played an under-recognized but really important role in spurring formal experimentation. The role of Western models in the transformation of Persian poetry after 1905 is the subject of the great scholar Mohammad Reza Shafi'i Kadkani's book, Ba Chiragh-o Ayine, with a lamp and a mirror, the last in a cluster of his works beginning with Sovarichial Dashere Farsi that are foundational for anyone considering the relationship between mimesis and convention in Persian poetics. In Ba Chiragh, Shafi'i Kadkani begins with his experience, after already beginning to think of writing a work with that title, of remembering M.H. Abrams' coincidentally similarly titled classic work of English New Criticism, The Mirror and the Lamp, which undertakes a similar study of the Romantic critic's transformation of how literary mimesis was understood. Shafi'i Kadkani, like Abrams, is concerned primarily with the problem of aesthetic representation and the development of a new regime of aesthetic representation in Persian verse under European influence. But as he notes, Romanticism only entered wide use as an Iranian literary category in the 40s under Soviet occupation, and then it was a term of abuse. It was the Zhdanov period. Like I said, the post-1905 reception of the Romantic was mostly indirect. As the critic Frank Ankersmit has shown, the re-theorization of aesthetic representation by the European Romantic critics was closely linked to a contemporaneous re-theorization of political representation involving the same terms and some of the same theorists, in particular Edmund Burke. Both in aesthetics and in politics, Ankersmit argues, the Romantics rejected a previous resemblance theory of representation. The artwork should hold a mimetic mirror to the object represented, and delegates should share their constituents' opinions and preferences and should be like their constituency. Instead of resemblance, the Romantics advocated a replacement theory of representation. The artistic representation or political representative was irreducibly different from the represented and stood in their place on their behalf. The working out of constitutionalist poetry's mimetic functions then was closely linked to the problem of political representation. Against the parliamentary form initially adopted in Iran, which was Burkean in its insistence that the old landed gentry could speak for the interests of the peasants before the Majlis, the first version of Lahuti's poem demands resemblance. Peasants can only be represented by peasants who want what peasants want. His later anti-Majlis stance appears at first glance to be against representation as such. The peasants must mobilize into their own anjumans that will take direct action. In practice, the vanguardism of anjumans and soviets entailed its own kind of replacement-based representation, even if the Leninist vanguard regarded this as temporary and left their own position under-theorized. By the same token, poetry was not tasked with portraying the Iranian people as they were, but constituting an image of them on their behalf. I don't wish to overstate the diffusionist aspect of this transformation. Significantly, the inter-imperial, interconfessional Persianate cultural zone was held together not only by high classical literature, but by an everyday idiom that was shared across colloquial languages. The incursion of this idiom into Turkic, Persian, and Caucasian Christian literatures knit them together in new ways and gave them influence over each other in ways that we could only call a diffusion from Europe, maybe in the ideological sense. But at the level of literary form, it would be better understood as a sort of low Persianate literary modernity, a feedback loop of mutual influence and reception among Persianate language newspaper literatures, which provided an autonomous fund of inspiration for poetic experiments in each of the communities beyond Europe. So let's look at some materials again. We see these political diffusionist and low Persianate regionalist literary modernities combined in another text on the perils of parliamentary representation, written for the newspaper Sura Esrafil by Dehoda, who we encountered briefly earlier. His satirical column's fictional illiterate narrator to explain his fear of the parliamentary component of constitutionalism compares Iran's situation to that of a woman over whom an unscrupulous man has been given power of attorney, who is now marrying her off. And here again, you can see formal play that engages with the solecisms of ordinary speech while being quite literary. Dehoda's illiterate narrator mispronounces Petersburg as Petalport, but this also means, according to Dehoda's own later dictionary of Persian, far and wide. In the longer run of the first half of the 20th century, this vernacular turn would enable the rise of literary prose of the sort pioneered by Dehoda relative to verse, and the hardening of divisions between increasingly siloed national literatures, each increasingly oriented to European rather than regional models. But this teleology is too often back projected onto the first two decades of the century, when, as I've argued already, direct orientation toward European literature was the province of a small elite that was by no means the primary driver of poetic experimentation and innovation. It was Turco-Persian verse that was a dynamic mass phenomenon. To illustrate this point, I will turn now to one of the most high-profile and influential instances of Persianate translingual transfer of poetic innovations, focusing on a low Persianate genre that has received extensive attention from subsequent Iranian, Turkish, and Transcaucasian literary historians and critics. I'm speaking of the Azeri verse of Sabir, resident poet of the Tiflis satirical magazine Mulla Nasreddin, and the Persian translations and adaptations of that verse by Sayyid Ashrafuddin Gilani, so-called Gilani, he's from Qazvin, in the newspaper he published in the northern city of Rasht called Nasim-e-Shamal. And the poetic genre that I have in mind is the lullaby, in Azeri the Layla, in Persian Lalai. And I'll say right away that because this talk is for a general audience, there will be plenty of background on these poets, periodicals, and the lullaby genre that will be familiar to scholars of modern Persian or Turkic poetry. But by the end, I hope that my approach to the poetics of political representation will have given some new significance to this familiar topic. You've already seen a bit of Mulla Nasreddin and Sabir's poetry for that magazine, the regional significance of which is hard to overstate. Not only is he widely regarded as the initiator of a complete transformation of Azeri language verse based on his experimentation with non-classical forms and his importation of ordinary and, more mockingly, official registers of speech into poetry, but the wide readership of Mulla Nasreddin across the Persianate zone made him a catalyst for experimentations in Central Asian and Iranian literature. After Sabir's untimely death, there was a similarly wide but longer duration circulation of a divan of his newspaper poems entitled the Hupupnama, after one of Sabir's pen names, Hupup, the hoopoo. Keep that choice of bird in mind. We'll come back to it. Dehoda and Lahuti were two among many Persian writers of the Constitution period who pointed to him as a transformative influence. But his most famous imitator was Ashraf Gilani, editor and resident poet of a more local Iranian newspaper, the one with wide popularity in northern Iran and Tehran. Ashraf does not enjoy the same unique status in Iranian poetic history that Sabir does in Azerbaijan, but it is widely recognized that he was the first to import many of Sabir's poetic experiments into Persian, and that, because of his broad appeal, he played an especially important role in popularizing such new verse styles and forms beyond the elite literati. And here you can see a backhanded epigram on Ashraf from the more highly regarded poet Bahar, who regarded him as a plagiarist, which just goes to show the degree to which conventions for literary translation were in transition at this time. But, I mean, what it is to bring poetry from one language to another might look like plagiarism. Ashraf continued producing Nasim until his death in the 30s, but the journal's literary significance was greatest in the long constitutional period. You should know one more thing about Nasim Ishtimal, which is less often part of discussions of the newspaper. Early on, at least one likely well-informed observer, Lucien Bouvard, a French Orientalist who was intimately involved in the Azeri press in the Russian Empire for reasons too involved to discuss here, introduced Nasim Ishtimal in a French Orientalist journal as the press organ of a very powerful North Iranian anjuman associated with the FIAM and then the Democrat Party, anjuman of Sattar Khan. So it is likely that Ashraf, too, worked closely with the Social Democrats early on. In this context, the title Nasim Ishtimal, A Breeze from the North, seems to have not only a literary meaning, but also a political one, not unrelated. Mullah Nasreddin was not a party newspaper and drew writers with various reformist and radical political orientations. And in the Russian Empire, this was much more common than in Iran, as there were longer periods when revolutionary parties were banned, but the press had some latitude in spite of censorship, which gave newspapers an incentive to keep their distance from direct party affiliation. Relative to a party newspaper like Iran-e-No, Nasim Ishtimal seems more populist than tendentious in a party discipline sense. For example, in his verse, Ashraf explicitly opposes the unveiling of women. But the distinctively northern, that is, Russian revolutionary politics that Ashraf brings into Persian verse is located less in stances on particular issues of the day than in an overall approach to voice. And so to the lullaby. You can spot a lullaby even if you don't read Arabic script by all the lines of print that are taken up, wasted from a typesetter's perspective, by the repetitive vertical lines of lai, lam, aleph, the many modern Turkic and Persian agitational poems in this form tend to have similar meters and similar strophic stanzas, but they are really united as a genre by this repeated international baby talk, lai. In most modern literary genre systems, the lullaby has no particularly strong significance, although the collection of lullabies played an ideologically important role in romantic nationalist folkloristics, and there have been modernist experiments with the form by Yeats, Langston Hughes, and Auden, Akhmatova, and Pasternak. It's an unusually transculturally recognizable genre among the verbal arts, given the special relationship of its embodied rhythm and intimacy to the universal physical necessity of rocking babies to sleep, and the widespread, although less universal, relationship between that practice and motherhood. It's a low genre, generally without named authors, and performed only in home spaces, except, as I say, in the museumified folk culture of romantic nationalism, where it takes on all the ideological charge that the mother-child bond takes on in a natalist motherland. Sabir's lullaby is unsigned, but it's printed for public distribution, not timeless, but dated at the top. And as far as I know, none of these lullabies were written to be sung, least of all by actual mothers. So what exactly is being staged here? This isn't a sentimental nationalist celebration of maternal love and self-sacrifice of the kind that Afsane Najmabadi describes so well in her work. Not yet, not in Sabir's version. In this first iteration, instead, we encounter the scapegoat of national modernizers the world over, the bad mother who fails to enlighten the next generation. I will recite in Azeri, and you can read the English on the slide. Terpen me amandur bala, gafletten ayılma, açma gözünü, habi cihaletten ayılma, laylay bala laylay, yat kaldala laylay, açsan gözünü, rencü meşakkat göreceksen, millette gam, ümmette küduret göreceksen, kıldıkça nezer millette heyret göreceksen, çık başına, yorganını, nikbetten ayılma, laylay bala laylay, yat kaldala laylay. Ali Asghar Sayyid Gohrab, in his excellent discussion of the constitutionalist lullaby, emphasizes its allegorical dimension, its place in the discourse of the East's slumber and awakening. In this case, as in a similar lullaby that Dehoda produced in imitation of Sabir, we are dealing with the patriarchal logic that situates the nation's ignorance in its superstitious women, whereas in later extensions of the constitutionalist lullaby form by Ashraf, Lahouti, and others, we encounter the good mother nation that laments her inability to save herself and begs her sons to save her. Sabir's adoption of the voice of the caricatured bad, neglectful mother, though, gives this a dramatic dimension in which the mother emerges not only as an allegorical figure, but a speaking character who brings both a female domestic genre and a great deal of household language, including baby talk, into published verse. This is in keeping with the theatrical quality of constitutionalist verse, which brought an influx of new poetic personae, recognizable as caricatures from everyday life, into what had traditionally been a tiny cast of classical personae. Hamid Reza Yazdi and others have discussed this polyphonic tendency in terms of the special role of monazire, debate, as a discursive formation of Iranian literary modernity. And in fact, even though the infant addressees rarely speak, the lullaby genre is contestatory, at least in its functional origin, where it is an attempt to get an unwilling child to fall asleep. So in this respect, there's always something uncanny to me about the proper national allegory lullabies that followed, in which we hear from the good mother nation who laments her sorrows to her child. And I'm showing you a couple of stanzas from a typical example of this sort by Ashraf. Here, the poet is ventriloquizing the idealized mother nation itself. This is an especially complete poetic claim to representative authority, to speaking for the nation. But the addressee within the conventions of the form is not the male citizen whom the poem calls to action, but a helpless child. In fact, even though the mother is not trying to hide the truth from her child, the addressee, as in the ironic version of the genre, she is nonetheless urging the child to desist from action as a disempowered hostage. Rather, this is a poetic scenario intended for overhearing by the nation of men who should be moved to indignance and intervention on behalf of the hostages. There are other poems framed as if songs that adopt a similar radical of presentation. I can talk about that more. Bridget Wiertey, in a superb survey of the lullaby genre, writes that, quote, while lullaby had long been a form in which an adult lyric masqueraded as a simple song of childhood and men claimed to sing as women, in the 19th and early 20th centuries, this practice became an instrument of cultural and class ventriloquism across racial, ethnic, and class boundaries. In the Northern Iranian press, this ventriloquistic lullaby was a special case with special allegorical significance of a broader seizure of representative and representational authority by the poetic voice as a stand-in for the more practical contestation of representative authority by the anjumans and sovets that stood against Shah and Tsar, and sometimes against Majlis and Duma. The resulting renegotiation of the contract between poet and patron and between poet and listeners or readers transformed poetic diction and the operation of classical genres in ways that would take half a century and two more generations of poet to explore fully. It wouldn't be hard to read such poetry through the post-1968 critiques of Leninist vanguard theory from the post-structuralists. who emphasize the usurpatory character of representation, how representative speech silences those for whom it claims to speak and arrogates power to the representative while denying that he, it's usually a he, is an independent agent at all. In our place and time, when the primary destabilizers of representative institutions are right-wing opponents of democracy as such, it's especially hard to imagine militia bands as facilitators of people power. But to conclude, I will ask you just for a moment to set aside these anjuman newspaper lullabies, usurpation of women's voices, their claims to speak for a reified nation, to set aside even their troubling allegories of the nation as good or bad mother, and pause at these poems' literal scenario. In a discussion of modern English adaptations of the lullaby genre, Lindsay Turner writes, quote, "The poetic form of the lullaby represents, at its origin, the simultaneous presence of poetic production and gendered domestic or reproductive labor. However, the lullaby's work-related origins are often obscured. As a folk genre, the lullaby records but does not aestheticize the contest of wills that is the effort to get a child to go to stay asleep." And at this moment, my three-year-old is sleeping one room over. I want him to sleep a little longer. Sabir and Ashraf may stand in judgment, but they understand me. And I will say that these poems bring into the civic sphere not only colloquial speech, even baby talk, but the raw struggle of lullaby as labor. This too, they say, can be sher, can be poetry. So I'll end, not with a newspaper poem, but a popular song, a tasnif, collected in E.G. Brown's 1914 Press and Poetry of Modern Persia. Brown notes the song's colloquial forms. It's not a lullaby, but it has the same intimate home language. And unlike the lullabies we've seen, it seems to have actually been for singing. I know of no scholarship in which the Menore Hanum who composed the song is identified, and I have not looked in Brown's archive for a source broadsheet, but there's no reason to doubt that this was written by a woman who chose to take up Sabir's pen name, Hupup, the hoopoe, the bird that speaks for all the other birds in Attar. It really is remarkable how something with such a potently real sound of the exhausting and exhausted home space in Persian can turn in translation into precisely the kind of sentimental, aestheticized lullaby of disgust. And I didn't like any of my own translations of this poem either. But I thought I should give the last word to Menare Hanum, her first, second, and last stanzas, even if I don't know her tune or whether this particular woman, depending on her region, would have said John, June, Jun, or something else. Here, the possibilities opened up by Sabir and the newspaper poets as the possibility of a medium for articulating a real politics of the people are fulfilled completely. Here, real subaltern politics, the attempt to keep your mother from weeping with anxiety over the price of bread, are expressed in a rich and deceptively complex verbal performance. So with that, I give you the second hoopoe after Sabir. Nana John, khob budam, khob didam. Mahi Ramazan shud Nana John. Nano gusht arzan shud Nana John. Khob man dorugh bud Nana John. هر چه دیدم دوغ بود ننه جان. ننه جان خواب بودم خواب دیدم. مشروطه به پا شد ننه جان. عش فقرا شد ننه جان. خواب من دروغ بود ننه جان. هر چه دیدم بود دوغ بود ننه جان. ننه جان گریه مکن قصه مخور. نان شکری میخرم و واسط. چادر زری میخرم واسط. تا تو فکر رخت میکنه ننه. Manasya bacht mikoni nana. So with that, thank you. And I'm really looking forward to your questions.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Hodgkin. That was an excellent talk. I really enjoyed that. And well, the floor now is open for questions. We have a lot of questions. I have chosen two of those, if you don't mind, because we have like 5-6 minutes. And I try to squeeze one of mine if time allows after that. Okay, and the first question is that, well, do you know about any circulation of these newspapers that you mentioned in Persian-speaking parts of India, South Asia. Dr. Sean Pugh mentions that he has encountered a collection of Mashruta poetry compiled in Calcutta.
There has been some really wonderful work on precisely this kind of exchange recently by Professor Afshin Marashi and Professor Alexander Jabari. It's not my expertise. I know that the Indian Parsi community was especially interested in this stuff. There's one work, Rastakhiz, this play about the emergence of a new Iran from the ruins at Persepolis that became a big hit and was performed in the Parsi community, but originated in the Istanbul emigre Iranian community, which gives you a sense of the sort of scope of this. But I would encourage you to look at the work of Professors Marashi and Jabari.
Okay, thank you so much. And we have Jane Lewison in audience. Hello to Jane. And she has this question about the poet, revolutionary poet Hakupian that you mentioned. Is he the same person as one of the major forces of recording the early 78 PR, RPM recordings?
No, he isn't. I can just say that this is a different Hakupian. It's a pretty common name, but this was a kind of proletarian poet in Baku. Yeah.
So it's not the one. Okay.
No, not the one.
Yeah. Well, thank you. I try to squeeze in one of my questions as well. Yeah. Well, although there are many direct references to the works of, like, to these Turkish models that you named them, especially Sabir and his Hoppokname, in both constitutional and post-constitutional era, but there are evidences of these poetry, constitutional and post-constitutional poetries being engaged with other marginal kind of poetry, I can say, inside Iran. Like in the case of Lahuti, we know that he is very inspired by 8 and 10 syllables Kurdish poetry.
Absolutely. He wrote a little bit of that as well,
yeah.
Which I wish I could read.
Yeah, of course, yes. And also about satirical poetry that you mentioned, you know, the influence of Hoppokname especially is crystal clear, but we also have this works of Yadmo Jandari in mid-1800s. He has this Kholasatul Iftisal, which is a great experimental in form, satirical poem, long poem, and he has this Sardar Nome, which are social-political satiric azals, actually quite impressive in form and content. So what do you think about that? What is the relationship between this as a background of social-political satirical work and like with the new modern constitutional and post-constitutional poetry?
Yeah, no, I mean, so this is one of the things that's sort of fascinating about the constitutional moment in poetry is not that like these genres are coming into existence, but there's this new reconfiguration of this field that's called sher, this field that's called adabiyat, that like groups together phenomena that would not have been grouped together before and renders in a preserved form, right, that we can access now, lots of stuff that like, I mean, we have plenty of satirical court poetry, right? And some stuff that came from like Sufi guilds, especially in the early modern period. But there's, I mean, there's just such a vast corpus that we don't have because, you know, I mean, it wasn't the voice of the ruling classes, basically. I mean, I think we can say. And it enters into the space of poetry. You know, like someone like Minare Khanum, who knows how many, you know, millions of these, you know, women singing down the ages, we just don't have their voices. And here, it's not that it comes into existence, it's that it comes into the record. And that's why I think this idea of the low Persianate is useful, that it's not all about, I mean, I think that the work of people like Mona Kia on adab, on sort of this, like, you know, high education as the form of, you know, of connection across the Persian world, it's very useful, it's very important. But I think that, like, there was a Persianate of the B adab also. There was a way in which when the newspapers started traveling back and forth between Istanbul and India and everywhere in between, there were things in the low culture that people could recognize and say, hey, that's just like, you know, my life here. And it's not all about, hey, I know Saadi as well. And so this kind of, this too is part of Persianate modernity, is this new way of knitting together the space, even if that falls away in later decades of, you know, state schooling and, you know, standardization of national languages and canons and all of that. We can't forget the possibilities that existed in that moment, in that geopolitics and geopoetics.
Okay. Yeah, thank you so much. I think we ran out of time. So once again, thank you so much for your great talk. I'm pretty sure that we continue this conversation later after this talk. And thank you everyone for your great questions. And I'm so sorry that we didn't have enough time to answer them. Thank you.
I'm so grateful that you all took the time to come and for your questions.
Great. Thank you so much. Thank you to Dr. Hodgkin for today's fantastic lecture on this relatively new area of focus. I'm sure there's a lot more to be discussed. I would also like to thank Dr. Somboldel and Dr. Afari at UC Santa Barbara for their continued collaboration on this talk series. Once again, we thank you all for joining us today from all over the globe. We thank you, and until next time, farewell. Thank you, Dr. Hodgkin. Thank you, Dr. Somboldel.
Thank you.
Have a great day.
You too.